We had in our area in New England and Rhode Island and southern Massachusetts, we had 300 fanciers at one time. I don't know how many there are now, but we had a good concentration, but not as close. We have the Unit 10 area here that there's approximately 100 fanciers in 1 square mile area. My four neighbors around me, they're all pigeon fanciers, so in every yard there's almost a loft here. Fanciers here, most of them are non-working, they're retired, and the people that come here to fly pigeons, most of the time, pigeons is a full-time job for them. I help organize that a group of fellows that we went to a lodge in southern Rhode Island for 3 days every season after the young bird season ended. And it was owned by Charles F. Watkins. Mr. Watkins wanted me to organize the New England Open 600 mile race.
Yes.
And with that, I helped organize it. And we began in 1970. And in 1970, it's still in operation now with a 15 bird limit. We used to ship almost every year 5,000 birds and 500 lofts. The highest point we had was we had 570 lofts and 5,700 birds 1 year. That is with a 15 bird limit. Plus the fact that we had a mileage thing that you had to fly 550 plus miles to qualify for it. And we could have picked up maybe another 200 lofts had we lessened the mileage, but in order to make it a legitimate 600 mile race, we made it with a mileage distance of 550 to qualify. But that was the beginning of it, and that began in 1970. And it's still going now. Of course, the lofts have diminished and the pigeon population has diminished since that time. That was an open.
Okay.
It was a very competitive area, especially distance area.
Okay.
Many times our birdage and lofts increased when it got to the 600 miles. Everybody was preparing for it and waiting for it.
Yeah.
And like I say, we flew one time 570 lofts and 5,700 birds. That is with a 15 bird limit, and that's not easy to do. But it was a great race.
Let them know who you are and let them know where we're at.
My name is Cody Pouche. We in Marrero, Louisiana. Been knowing this handsome fella for about a year on Facebook.
Yeah.
And it's an honor to get to meet him in person today, him and his wife. So we're glad to have him down here in Marrero.
Thanks, man. Pleasure to be here. And I really enjoyed being out here seeing New Orleans.
And next time we got to plan more time so we can have more time.
I know, man. I didn't have time. But tell these people why you have pigeons. Why do you have these animals?
These pigeons are whenever I'm having a bad day, I come in the loft and, you know, therapy. Just have a little peace of mind. I have a little, it's therapy for me. So it's my way to relax, forget everything else about what's going on. It's just me and the birds focusing on them, talking with them, feeding them, taking care of them. That's my therapy, and that helps me to go about my daily life. And it mellows me out as a person, makes me a better person, knowing I just gotta be here for these birds. You know, I ain't out on partying because I know I gotta wake up the next morning and take care of my birds. So, and it just helps you to become a better person. And the kids in the neighborhood love it. Hopefully I find some of these little fellas and groom them to be pigeon racers one day too. So that's the main reason I enjoy doing a pigeon racing. I'm a rookie. This is only my second season flying your own birds. So
tell these folks what you do for a living.
I work for the sheriff's office at Plaquemines Parish. I currently sergeant in the Special Services Division. I go to the schools and I teach about drugs, drug abuse resistance education, just helping them become better citizens in the community, making the right choices,
yeah.
And just a people person.
Yeah.
This has been my motto and my way of living for a long time. Meet three people a day and do one good deed a day, and that's each and every day. That's my purpose of waking up, and that's my goal to accomplish that. Meet three people and do at least one good deed a day. I race with the New Orleans Pigeon Combine. We got about 25 members. We ship usually anywhere from 400 to 600 birds on an average weekend race. I'm the youngest one in the club. The next one older than me might be 55. I mean, then the rest of them 65 to 83 years old to 90 years old. That's a dying sport, so I've been doing my best to recruit people, new blood, to get in the sport of pigeon racing, so it won't die and just
That's a beautiful red check.
They got this one guy in that club, boy. That's all he races. Reds.
Reds? Really?
Love reds. My best race and the most memorable race was our last race of the young bird season. It was our auction bird race. Excuse me on the lingo because I'm still learning y'all pigeon terms and everything.
Yeah.
But it was our auction race. They paid out the first 30 birds, and it was the first time this entire year that I had two or more birds on a drop.
Yeah.
I had four birds coming. I had five birds in the money race. Four of the five clocked in. It was on four on the drop.
Whoa.
I was just so excited. Once I got them birds in, I was probably jumping 6-8 foot in the air, just doing cartwheels back. That's how excited I was. So I clocked 19th, 21st, 23rd, 24th in that race. That was that's the positions I won, and that's, I never forget that.
Yeah.
Great. To win a 400-mile race as a rookie,
yeah,
beating some of these big-timers that's been in the sport for 20, 30 years, made me very proud of my birds and myself.
Yeah.
So
it's a lot of hard work.
I never forget about it. I never forget that race as long as I live. I'm going to live on to tell that story for years to come.
How do you feel on race day? When those birds are in the air and you know you're waiting for them, how do you feel?
It is so exciting to see these birds come home from... I know the first race, that first Saturday, my partner from Slidell calls and said, man, I got one. So I come outside. The minute I walk out my back door, boy, you can hear the wings popping, coming over the house. Sure enough, went right in, and that day I placed 21st on my first race. So on a 100 mile race, so I was excited about that one too. Just to see them birds come in, and I don't think I lost any birds that first race. So I was really pumped up and excited about it. So I couldn't wait. I couldn't wait for the next weekend to get here to race again.
Yeah, it's a lot of excitement.
Very, very exciting.
Got it. You've done well with birds. Your club helped you with getting birds?
Man, I had so many people I got to thank throughout this pigeon career, pigeon journey. From Larry Johnson, just from me being a kid, just to knowing his story and never really getting to know him as a person, but just knowing he was the legend in my childhood, knowing he had the best bird in the country at one time, they said.
Yep.
It was on the front page of a magazine. I always remember that as a kid, 5, 6, 7 years old. And then I was growing up, you know. Then once I saw Mike Tyson on the Animal Planet, man, I said,
yeah,
it just lit a spark. And I said, I'm building me one. And just decided, I got everything donated, so I basically don't have nothing costs.
Yeah.
Everything was given to me. I told them what I was doing. They said, man, I love to help you out. So they just give me 2x4s, all the wine, everything.
Yeah. So literally, you don't need to spend a lot of money to enjoy yourselves.
Man, you don't have to spend no money, man. Just hustle you up some 2x4s, a little roofing material, whatever you call it, metal.
Yeah, metal, whatever you can get. Whatever you can get.
Whatever you can get, and just go with it, man.
Yeah.
It ain't how much a bird costs, I can tell you that right now, man. It's just, if you show them birds some love and respect, they're gonna treat you right. They're gonna come home to daddy.
Yeah.
And it's been proven.
Well, it's been a pleasure to come out here and meet you.
Absolutely, Jose. And I want to thank this guy, man. Just seeing him on Facebook, being an advocate for the sport, you know, I really respect that, because they need more people like him and myself just out on Facebook, being a positive face on the Facebook social network and media, is that's how we're going to get new blood in the sport. I mean,
yeah,
all these old timers are dying off, so it's our turn to pay back to the sport of pigeon racing and do what we can to make it succeed and be able to have our grandkids and our dead kids racing and pigeon racing.
Yeah, beautiful places.
You never meet anybody like you meet Southern Louisiana people. I mean, we just happy-go-lucky. We love meeting people, doing what we can to help them and making them feel at home. And
yeah,
that's why I just wish I had a little bit more notice for you to, you know,
oh, get, that's all right,
get
man.
A little bit more warm.
See, that's the thing. I can't give people notice because then they start cooking for me, barbecuing
yeah,
for me.
Yeah, that's what we would have had.
So. And I'd have been out here till 2 or 3 days, and I can't do that to people.
Yep.
You know, I have to kind of pop in on people and say, hey, I'm in your neighborhood.
Well, hey, you caught me by surprise, and I was excited, though.
If I didn't, then you'd been cooking for me.
Oh, yeah. We would have had a little jambalaya cooked for you. We had a like, nice little seafood.
We wouldn't be paying $99 a meal like we are downtown.
Yeah.
But it's a pleasure to be here, man.
Same here, Jose.
Thanks, man.
Nice meeting you.
Thank you so much for sharing with me, man.
Thank you.
Well, what makes it special is that you have probably the highest concentration of pigeon fanciers in a very small area than ever existed in one area. Many years ago, when we had more fanciers than we do now, there were a lot of great centers like the Pittsburgh Center and Detroit and many good areas. But Spring Hill is different. The weather is sensational. When I grew up in the New England area, Morris Gordon was a mentor and one that I appreciated, and he was very kind to me, and one of the best breeders I ever owned, Morris Gordon, gave me. He was one of the best, and there are many, many outstanding fanciers in the United States. Through the years, many outstanding fanciers. You've had in Florida, you've got fellows like Randall Berkey and Art Hees, and through the years, many fanciers like Hank Bernazer in California, Eddie Lorenz, outstanding fan. There are many good fanciers through the years.
This is Sunshine Grove. It comes off of Highway 50 heading north, and this is where all the pigeon lofts are on the north side of Spring Hill. This is Eskimo Curlew. This is where like a lot of lofts are. You're gonna notice there's pigeon lofts just about everywhere on the street and in trailers too. You can buy a house out here for like $60,000 cash off like 2 acres. And it's not really worth anything because your house can sink into a sinkhole. Pigeon lofts right there. Way off in the distance. Excuse my camera, it's really humid and rainy and it messes up my camera. But that's Grande, he was a champion last year. First place, best racer in town. Tito's house right here, we're pulling up to. As you can see, there's pigeon lofts just about everywhere. Hey! This guy next door is Ron Tipton. And he's from Port Charlotte, and Tito's from Port Charlotte too. Just all the pigeon guys move in here because there's, you know, so much pigeon stuff to do. It's just a place to move if you're into pigeons.
I saved you 5 this year.
Nice.
Yeah.
Tomorrow's 500 mile race.
Oh yeah.
Tomorrow we're going 500 miles.
Yeah, 500 miles tomorrow.
Okay. Last year you got first place.
Last year, 500, I got first place.
Well,
you know, hope I do the same thing tomorrow.
Tomorrow, yeah.
I didn't even strike twice.
Yeah.
What do you say? You know, these are all my babies here. I have 140 babies right now.
Well,
most of them old money birds. I got, I'm pretty much full for the classic already. I still got a few open space up. Well, these other babies, they look good. You see the field was clean.
Yeah.
But When you get out of birds, man, they get dirty so quick. These are my birds right here. My Hoovins family. Smoky Bluebirds are my Hoovins. See how they do tomorrow, my babies. Got a lot of good birds here. Somebody put a white pigeon for the class. Look.
All white?
All white. I don't know who did that. Somebody sent it to my house. In case you went over there.
Yeah. Where you got birds from this year?
From everywhere.
Everywhere?
Yeah. Hawaii.
Cool.
Puerto Rico. Really.
So you got birds from Puerto Rico, Hawaii.
Puerto Rico, Hawaii, California, everywhere.
Nice.
Wisconsin, a friend of mine sent me about 8 classic birds and 5 $50 band birds.
Cool.
I got everything you see here is all money birds. You see any bird with a white band? Those are the birds that I bred. Those are my birds. All in here is all money. I'm in it to win it.
Yeah. How did you do last year? Apart from the 500 mile race, what else did you do last year?
I did pretty good. I was second. I had the bird for champion bird for 2 weeks. I hold them back because the wind was gonna be bad. I didn't wanna lose him or whatever, so I just ship him. So he went down on champion bird, but it doesn't matter. Good pigeons, you don't throw good birds away.
You also had one in the big one loft race here that was good.
In Big Andy's house, I put 6 birds in it. And I got 4 back, but the one that I won money with, she went to 400 miles, and I don't know if she's back or not. I don't know. I have no information about that race.
Yeah.
The second race, she came in, and she got $1,000. The third race, she came in 16. They only paid the first 15 birds, but she lost money by seconds.
Yeah.
And she's out of my hoovings. My hoovings, I always clock my birds. They fly all distance, you know?
So, the first year here, you did good, but the 500 mile race, first place, that was a good accomplishment.
Yeah, but right now, all birds right now, I'm in 4th place in champion bird, 4th place in average speed, and 8th place in champion law. So, we still got 2 more races to go, so let's see how we do, you know? I'm just happy that I'm having a good year, you know?
Yeah.
But when the year goes by, you get better, so, and you learn by your mistakes.
Yeah.
So I did pretty good, I'm happy. I got these beautiful babies now, and I'm about to build a big aviary, 22 feet wide, 40 feet long, for the babies to go out and play and do what they gotta do, learn how to trap, and once they do that, I'll let them out, let them fly.
There's that Big Andy one loft race.
Yeah.
I think there's a pigeon on the roof.
Yeah.
I gotta pick up birds that we got there.
Yeah, you gotta take them
back. 200 feet long.
He's there now.
No, I got it now. There we go.
Get the father.
So that's baby Tito right
baby
there.
Baby Tito, look at the father right there.
Yeah. Oh. Yeah, I see him. These are the ones I made. Which one of these, to all these, which one means the most to you?
The 500 mile one.
500 mile race.
Yeah. That one over there.
Right there.
The plate.
First place.
That's going to win tomorrow again.
Tomorrow is another 500. This is last year.
Drink?
2015, so.
We got beer, wine.
I don't know what I'm going to do.
You like it up or you don't want to go, huh?
I'm going to step it for a little bit. And there's your neighbor cleaning the coops.
He gonna be shit. He is actually right?
And shit. How much are they asking for it?
I think $1,000.
Man.
That's cheap.
Hey, it's better than mine.
you gotta fix it, you know what I'm saying?
But you gotta fix it.
You put a bed in there and see with the pigeons.
This is me, buddy.
All right, what's your name, sir?
My name is Toni Smith.
All right, where are we at?
We're in Mitchell County, Georgia.
All right.
I got a bacon and address, but we're more or less like Leicester, Georgia.
All right.
And a mile down dirt road in the country.
Tell them what you, tell these guys what you're doing here in the club. As far as the songs.
I am trying to play the pigeon game.
All right. How long have you had pigeons?
1 year.
1 year?
1 year.
Really?
1 year.
Nah.
1 year. Swear to God. And decided to revert to the pigeon.
All right.
So here I am.
How do you do your first year flying in?
How do I do what?
How do you do that first year you were flying in? Last year?
Oh. Come out champion in every aspect of the game, whatever category they got. I guess I took them all, but I got some good birds from some good people.
Mm-hmm.
So that helped a lot too.
Got it.
And this year I'm on my own. I got to breed my own, buy my own, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
And so I hope to.
You were getting all your birds from one drop mostly? They would all come together?
Well, in the beginning, yes, they were really dropping. Further out I got, the more they started coming in twos and threes, ones and twos. These are really good people in this combine. They very, very generous to help a young flyer. I'm gonna say that off the spot. They
yep.
help me. They gonna help him. And it's basically, help a person out and get the birds in the loft, and then they're on their own. That, well, it's one of them situations where you're either interested or you're not.
Yep.
And the people who are, they go at it full steam. This one situation where most people not, excuse my French, they're not half-assing it, that people get in it, they either get into it head over heels or they don't even play with it. And but then money comes into part. A lot of people wants to fly, and they get looking at the money dollars and building a loft and this and a clock, and they go,
it's too much.
Too much just for a hobby. Going into it to try to learn how to breed a good pigeon and race where there is money.
Yep.
Because I'm used to making money off my roosters, and I want to try to transfer that over to the pigeon industry.
It's very difficult to do
it.
I'm sure
it is. It's difficult in fighting chickens.
Yeah.
I'm presently a member of the Dixie Combine.
Okay.
They're located out of Fancier, Georgia. Home base. There's about 12-14 members in this Dixie Combine. We got three clubs. We got the Fancier Club, the Albany Club, and the South Georgia Club. I'm a member of the South Georgia Club. But combined is a Dixie Combine, and we're presently flying O birds.
All right.
And it's pretty interesting. The older guys, a lot older than me, not in age, but been flying pigeons.
Mm-hmm.
I'm only flying about 10 or 12 pigeons. Reason is, these guys gave me some good birds last year, and I don't want to lose them. I want to breed them. I've done well with them. So if I do good well with them, then I can carry on. And but they're very, very, very competitive, and they love the sport.
Yep.
From what I can see of them, and what I can tell talking to them, and competing against them, they love the sport.
Great.
Yes, team, this is a few birds from everybody in the combine.
This is the birds that help you get the results.
Yep.
Nice.
From all kinds.
Yep. Is there any particular bloodline? Did that make a difference here while you're racing, or no?
Well, yes. Reggie King, believe it or not, he gave me some really good birds. I had a bird of the fastest bird of the year given to by him, but he keeps poor records, so he don't know where it come from. He don't know what kind it is,
but it comes from his loft.
Yep.
Okay. Is there a particular pigeon that you know you liked a lot that did real good?
Oh, the first one home, I like him the best.
All right,
but they've all it changes. You get you get the first bird this week, then next week it may be six birds down.
Yep.
That comes in first, and it's weaving back and forth.
Yeah, sometimes you'll get one bird that really stands out, you know?
Well, that'd be one of the Reggie King birds. That's 1539.
Yep.
And he's out there somewhere. He's got a white flight. He's a blue check with a white flight.
There we go. So this is one of your baby winners right here?
That's it.
Nice little blue bar.
Young bird winner. Blue bar splash. Flight.
Yep.
No, a blue bar white flight.
Yep. Sure is pretty.
A little bit of splash on his eyes.
Oh, he's tough. Look at him.
Oh, yeah. Maybe a cop.
Yeah, probably it.
Hey, y'all.
This is the babies. They're going to fly this year.
It's the babies I'm going to fly this year.
They sure are good looking.
Oh, they've been flying for like about a month. I've been flying them every day for a month.
They look good. I see that the club down here, everybody gets along pretty good.
Oh, yeah.
And you guys all kind of work together.
We have controversies every now and then. When they turn them loose and.
Oh yeah, of course. That's everywhere. The things that happen here.
I gotta work. You ain't gotta work. All that kind of stuff.
Yeah. You know that's not just here. That's everywhere. That's just about everywhere. If you love it, you'll do it. That's for sure. It's a lot of effort.
I've only done it all my life. I'm gonna build a loft like this. I'm gonna do it all the way.
A loft this nice, this huge, their first year. That's a big choice to make right there, you know?
It is. But if you're gonna do it, you might as well do it right. And well, I'm also building a house.
Yeah.
And I took some of my funds from building a house, which made my wife really mad. And I applied it to this loft.
Yeah.
Because I said, if I'm gonna fly pigeons, you gotta have somewhere to fly from. So you might as well build something.
Decent, yeah.
And I just, you know, the planets lined up to where I took some money from my house and put into this, and there you go.
Yep.
Oh.
When I looked at your results, I didn't, never would have crossed my mind it was your first year flying. I figured you already been.
Oh, yeah. No. I've had it in my dreams.
Yep.
All my life, you know, I've had little pigeons in houses and stuff, but.
Oh yeah, as far as racing.
That's what I wanted to do.
Okay, this is Tony's loft on the outside. It's beautiful.
The thing they need, they just want to get on
the ground. It's huge, this is like 14 by 40 or something, right?
Yeah.
They're individual green.
Yeah. You're right, about 14 foot wide, about 40 foot long.
This is his breeding, individual breeding cages, they're huge. They're probably like 6 by 12 or something, 6 by 14. So there's a lot of them.
And, 5 or 12.
Yep, a lot of good breeding space. There's a lot of just wide open lofts.
It gets hot up here.
It gets hot and muggy, huh?
Hot and humid. Man, it gets.
These are going tomorrow for a long race. They look beautiful. Some good looking birds. And they go way up. So how far are they going tomorrow?
They going 400.
Yeah.
I was full competition. And I went everything I could do. I read every book I could pick up. And I said, I'm going to beat these boys.
But you did it though.
And I smoked their butt.
Yep.
And now they won't know what I'm doing. Like, what are y'all asking me this shit for?
Yeah. So these two aren't flying, they got babies and they're in love. They got other things on their mind other than flying. They got other things on their mind other than flying right now. They got love.
Oh, they'd love to get out of there.
They're thinking about love right now, they're not thinking about flying. There you go.
I'm Stuart Harvard. You're at Marengo Creek Farms in Opelika, Alabama. And glad you're here. My grandfather had a restaurant, and he had a lot of guys that came in from the pigeon club. He was interested in racing pigeons in Columbus, Georgia. And then when he retired and I was 10 years old, he said, okay, let's get some racing pigeons. And that's how we got started.
Great. What do you enjoy the most about pigeons?
Of course, I like it all. I enjoy breeding a lot.
You enjoy breeding?
Trying to get a little better each year. You know, of course, I love racing too, but I really enjoy the breeding aspect of it. You know, you just can't see the brain and you can't see the heart. And to me, those are two of the most important parts. We can feel for certain things for, you know, the dog, the bird strong enough, or, you know, these kind of things, size, that kind of thing. But the most important, you can't see.
Okay. Is there any event in your pigeon racing history, lifetime, that is the most memorable to you?
Gosh, there's been several.
So can you share some of those with us?
I've been lucky. In 2009, they had it was called the Southeastern Open Race, and we flew from Cairo, Illinois. There was, I think, 8 different states competing, so once it was an old bird race, it was 420 miles for me. And we won the 400-mile section, we won the Alabama championship, and we won the overall in 2009, and then was able to do it again in 2012.
Okay. Anybody that you've met during your pigeon racing career that was memorable to you, somebody you were really happy to meet?
I was very happy when I got to go to the Jansen brothers' house and get to meet Louis Jansen. That was in 2007. One of my dear friends that helped me a lot to get started when I got back into the pigeons. I got out for a while and I got back in 2000. Toni Melucci was a great guy and helped me a tremendous amount. And then going to Belgium and getting to meet different flyers over there, Andre Rudhoft and Serge Van Elsacker and Eric Bergmos, and you know, just lots and lots of really good flyers over there. And they all have kind of the same philosophy, keep it simple.
Yes.
You know, one of the most important things that Serge ever told me was, you know, Stuart, the more you medicate, the more you must medicate. I medicate very little.
Unless it's absolutely necessary.
That's the only time. That's the only time. I try to just keep them healthy, natural health. And, you know, if you have, you know, you think about it, if you have 100 young birds and you have one or two that are sick, everybody's getting the same food, everybody's living in the same place, but you have one or two get sick. Why did they get sick and the other 98 not sick? It's because they're weak.
Yeah.
You got to move them out. You got to take them out. You can only breed, healthy birds and birds that have ability. I try to breed in order of finish. I have a couple different ways I breed. I have inbred families that I cross, and I also have birds that I breed that are just racing birds. And I'm trying to decide which is the best. Yep, young birds are out. They're out playing in the beautiful day.
I can say I've traveled a lot in the South, and this out here in Alabama is some of the most beautiful country I've seen.
It's a nice place out here.
Absolutely beautiful out here.
Lucky to be here.
This is one of the most beautiful places I've visited. These are some of the most beautiful old birds I've seen.
Thanks.
They are so beautiful. You've got the pine needle in the back.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And you've got wood crate floors.
Yep.
Everything goes down.
Yep. And then I have a couple chickens underneath. Keeps everything scratched up, cleaned up, and they pick up the grain, whatever grain's left over. I would normally not have so many old birds,
mm-hmm.
but the reason I have so many old birds, I have about 100 old birds.
Well,
the reason I have that many is because we have a charity race here for Alzheimer's.
Yes, for Alzheimer's.
So we had the charity race 2 weeks ago, and that's why we do it. And people sponsor a bird.
Yes.
We raised $11,000 for Alzheimer's. These birds raised $11,000 for Alzheimer's.
That's great. It's a good cause.
So it's a great cause, and people really like it. And I think it helps, tells more people about the sport.
Yeah.
And which to me is very important, of course.
Absolutely.
And
So I enjoy doing it. It's the third year we've done it for Alzheimer's.
Great.
And it's like a one-loft race, mm-hmm. but they're all my birds.
Yeah.
And you sponsor a bird. You don't get the bird, but you sponsor a bird.
Yeah.
And then what we do is half the money goes to Alzheimer's, half the money goes to the first 10 birds that come in. And what we do is we put everyone's name on the board.
Yeah.
And then the morning of the race, when the birds are flying back, we draw the numbers out of a hat. Whoever's name is next, that's your bird.
Yeah.
The next one we pull up, that's your bird. You know, like that. So it's fair, and it's just for fun. It's just a charity.
It's a great cause.
So that's the reason I have so many old birds. But I have about 50 pair in here right now. I torch my lofts 2-3 times a year.
Mm-hmm.
Take everything out, clean it good, and then torch it. Mm-hmm. We would clean every day, but we deep clean everything about once a month normally.
Mm. These are some of the most beautiful old birds I've ever seen.
Thank you.
So beautiful.
And I have about the same. Over, I put the cocks down here and the hens in the other section.
Wow, these are so beautiful. They are beautiful old birds. And they're not even scared by our presence here.
No.
They got enough space so they know they're not...
They're okay. They're not threatened.
They're not threatened at all.
No.
And for some people, it's almost, if you're not born with that sense...
You can't learn it.
It's not something you can learn.
No. I try to teach a lot of people about different animals, the dogs or the sheep or the pigeons and...
Not everybody gets it.
No, some people it just comes so naturally, and some people. I only have about 40 or so. But see, like next weekend, I'll do a release. I've got a release for a hospital over in Auburn, Alabama.
Yeah.
And then we do a lot of funerals. We do probably 4 or 5 funerals a week.
They're just enjoying the beauty here.
Yeah, they'll come in before dark. And you know, right here, I don't have much problems with hawks. Believe it or not, the sheep are not trained. The dog makes it look like the sheep are trained, but they're not. They wouldn't be coming over here without the dog. It all depends on where the dog goes as to where the sheep are going to go. He puts pressure on them. He's not allowed to bite them. He's not allowed to bark at them. He just has to put pressure on them with his eyes and his presence. All right, now watch the dog.
Oh, he's coming back now.
Nap. I can move 3 sheep or I can move 500 sheep. He's only 18 months old. This is a 2-bird clock. You can only clock 2 birds.
Wow.
Isn't that
I've
crazy?
Never seen this mechanism.
And then you'd put the counter mark in there, uh-huh. Turn it, it starts your clock. They keep... It's kind of funny. But, yep, that's how we did it. It's called a unique pigeon timer.
Wow.
I went to a restaurant one time in Belgium, and the entire inside of the restaurant, all the way around, had like a little shelf that came out, mm-hmm. all the way around. They were antique.
Real antique ones. Wow.
Yeah, there were hundreds.
It's just an older fucking clock.
Hunter's Cup.
Yeah, so I asked him, what's your favorite trophy? And that's his favorite trophy right there. How did it feel when you won this one?
It was fantastic. We've been close before, but finally to win it, it was a good feeling. They started out with around 900 birds that year, and she was a phenomenal racer. I'll show her to you.
Absolutely sinking.
She is a phenomenal racer, though.
For somebody else. That's okay. It's not too bad.
It's nasty.
Nah. Young birds are beautiful.
Everything.
Flashes. They're beautiful. Flying loft up in Brooksville.
Mm-hmm.
This is exactly how they breed, 3x3 cages.
Yep.
3x3 cages.
Like it,
I think it's a very good setup. So he's a Huffkin?
His Rocket and Phantom.
Wow. He's got that Phantom. Look at all the splash on him.
Mm-hmm.
And this is Pinnacle.
Pinnacle.
Which is the one that had that big...
The Mercedes. Mercedes winner.
Yeah.
And then this is an Oldbird. He's much bigger than any other cock that I'm breeding, but he's super buoyant. You gotta handle this one. He's super strong, super buoyant. He was always on the first drop in the young bird races, every race. And then he was one of my best old birds for 2 years.
He's beautiful, very alert. All right, now we're talking. Absolutely beautiful.
He's a very nice cock.
He's very alert.
I've got a lot of really good birds in here.
May I ask, what are the biggest differences between racing pigeons in the United States and Belgium, specifically liberations, training, just the whole race system?
Well, the program is different in one way, in that we fly at young birds and old birds at different times of the year. In Belgium, they're, and in Europe, many times they're flying young birds at the same time as the old bird season's being flown. The old bird season normally ends at distance races. Perpignan International finishes the first week in August, and they still flying young birds at that time. And they begin with the young bird series about the second week of May. And so during May and June, while they're flying old birds, they fly a young bird series at the same time. Most of the important races begin in August, late July and August, the provincials and national races and young birds. So they're flying at the same time, old birds and young birds. It's a very difficult thing. Most of the pigeon flyers in Belgium and in Europe are professionals. In Belgium, you have a lot of professional flyers that fly different distances. You have young bird specialists, you have old bird specialists that fly sprint races, and you have the international races, which are made up of the countries of Germany and in Holland and in England and France and Belgium, and those races, there's people that just concentrate on those races. They're long distance races, and there's a difference. They specialize in certain areas of racing, and but the competition level is very good. And a good fancier in England or America or anywhere else, he's a good fancier.
It
doesn't mean that one is better than the other, but there are more professional offs in Belgium than anywhere else that I know in the world.
Okay. So the American racing pigeon fancier, who's a competitor here, can be a competitor anywhere if he...
Yes, a good fancier is a good fancier. And if he's in an area where there are only a few lofts, nobody knows that he's a good fancier. And of course, you have to be in the big ballpark to get the publicity and the notoriety that people get from accomplishing what they do. But a good fancier is a good fancier.
Yeah, that's my beer. Just so you guys know, we are a 500 mile race, and we already missed some birds. But we're here, 500 mile race. About 10 birds down.
Eso fue lo que le pasó. Se quedó afuera. Ah, ya ve lo que pasó.
Una cucharadita de vinagre.
¿Viste esa paloma cómo venía?
5 días.
¿En agua?
En el agua.
¿Para la paloma?
Y, no, y ahí se lo quité. Ese día que lo estaba machimón, dije, lo cogí así. La
alta. That's the first bird I've been able to catch on its way down.
Raúl, aunque te sorprendiste ayer.
It's the first one I've been able to catch. The landing here is tough. There it goes.
Le trajeron los pichones.
Sí, mira.
Este ya sabía que se había confundido.
Maybe a grizzle? lost it for a second here. There it goes. Paloma, paloma. Se me perdió. La perdí, la perdí. Disculpame, gente, estamos aquí. La cámara está lenta.
Y entonces
estamos durmiendo, las palomas están afuera. Qué lindas están esas palomas, ven.
Pero no, 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 de verdad te digo que los huevos son
buenos. Oye, una cayó por el techo y no marcó.
A ver, ahí me corrió por ese cruce. Limbord, Hopkins, Janssen.
Hay una en el techo que no entró. Cayó por ahí arriba, no sé.
A lo mejor no está.
Ahí se tiene una arriba del techo por acá. Think about someone.
Saúl, se fue una para allá atrás.
Hay una arriba del techo.
Arriba del techo hay una.
Ahí viene otra, viene otra.
Ahí está, bien.
Ahí está. Let's try and catch it on the video. Oh.
Sabes que no conviene tener el palomar tan abierto.
Paloma. Cinco palomas. Cinco palomas. Uno se desprendió. Paloma, paloma. Miró para atrás, esa es de aquí.
Oh, mira, 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 el bald eagle.
¿Dónde está el águila? Bald eagle, straight ahead. Pigeon, right there. There's our pigeon. There's our pigeon.
Coño, muchachos, si te llegas a tirar.
Cinco, cinco. Lo estamos durmiendo hoy, el palomero hoy no está pitando.
Mira otra más.
A ver si. Ahí vienen dos. Ahí se cruzaron.
Oye, Saúl.
Saúl, estamos perdiendo tiempo, chico. Ahí entró una loca para adentro.
Se me está haciendo una muerta.
It's not a house. No, that's not a house, that's a pigeon loft.
Saúl Montalvo. Y vengo de Puerto Rico.
Ok.
Tengo paloma desde los 7 años. Compito desde 1979 en Puerto Rico, por encima del agua. Perdón, debe estar un poquito más llena.
Marvin me manda una fotografía de una roja.
Ahora sí.
¿Ah, sí?
Sí, Holanda, ¿te acuerdas cuando yo tenía chavo?
Ah, sí. Ah, no, pero está bien.
Está bajito.
Ah,
para estar bajito está bueno. Está bajito. Yo, el papá de esa paloma no pesaba una onza, mano.
Alguien me estaba hablando mucho de eso.
Y mi papá, cuando yo me gradué de primer grado,
sí,
me regaló un par de palomas. Yo trabajaba en un banco en okay. Puerto Rico por 26 años. Entonces me retiré y quería una mejor vida para mí y para mi familia. Y entonces decidí venirme para Pigeon, no con intenciones de volar palomas, sino de buscar una mejor calidad de vida.
Okay.
Pero no, se me presentó la oportunidad de volar palomas con este señor, Víctor La Madrid.
Sí.
Él es mexicano y tiene muy buenas palomas en México, entonces compró esta propiedad y me dijo que si le volaba sus palomas y aquí estamos voy para 3 años con él.
Ok. En esos 3 años, ¿qué evento tú has disfrutado más?
Las 600 millas del año pasado en adulto.
Ok.
Estaba ganando, gané todos los average speed.
Ok.
De media, larga y overall.
Sí.
Estamos a la orden, lo que quiera, aquí estamos en confianza, de verdad que sí.
Sí. Marathon distance, ¿tuviste una paloma que fue la mejor?
Sí, la mejor marathon distance el año pasado.
Wow, ok. ¿Qué resultados tuvo esa paloma para lograr eso?
Un segundo de 500, un tercero de 600 y un tercero en 400. Lo que pasa es que no cogió triple crown porque el JC no va a las 600 completas, ¿ves?
Sí.
Y se quedó corta por 25 millas.
Ok, entiendo. Las carreras de 500 y 600 millas son importantes aquí.
Sí, claro.
Sí, especialmente para la gente mayor, por lo que entiendo.
Bueno, lo que pasa es que la gente se enfoca en los clásicos y en las carreras de pichones porque hay que estar dinero, ¿eh?
Claro.
Pero las carreras de adultas son tan importantes para mí o más que las de,
sí,
las de pichones. Porque okay, hay que tú pruebas la paloma si en realidad
es dura.
Claro.
Okay. ¿Cuáles líneas ustedes recomiendan para distancia?
Bueno, yo estoy empezando aquí en la Florida y recuerda que la Florida es diferente a tal vez a otros estados.
Sí.
Yo lo que vuelo son prácticamente sojin. Ellas vuelan de 100 a 600 con buen viento.
Okay. ¿Repite la línea?
Sojin.
Ok.
Ellas vuelan bien de 100 a 600 con buen viento. También te vuelan de con viento de frente, pero no son todas, ¿ves?
Sí.
No son todas.
Llevo 3 días grabando con ellas.
Sí. Tienen aire acondicionado, si pasara cualquier cosa, pues tienen su aire acondicionado. Las jaulas son amplias para que puedan criar.
Sí.
Cuando las palomas, los pichones tan grandes, se ponen en el piso.
Sí.
Y entonces se dejan que las palomas vuelvan, como están aquí.
Sí.
Vuelvan otra vez a producir.
Sí. Esas casas son como de 3x3x3.
Sí, más o menos.
Entonces el espacio, la limpieza aquí es esencial.
Sí. Aquí se limpió todos los días. Hoy no fue la mejor limpieza porque estaba esperando paloma en la carrera.
Claro.
Se limpia todos los días.
Okay.
Este es el palomar de vuelo, si lo quieres ver.
Está impresionante. Este es el palomar de vuelo.
Este es el palomar de vuelo.
Wow.
Tiene 10 divisiones.
10 divisiones, mi gente. Wow. Esto es un estoraje inmenso.
Sí.
Wow. De afuera no se aprecia el tamaño del palomar.
De afuera no se aprecia.
Wow.
Aquí tengo los pichones que van este año a empezar a volar.
Sí.
Es un aviario que da hacia afuera para que...
Es inmenso igualmente. Wow. O sea, las divisiones son como de 10x10.
O
10x8 más o menos.
Sí.
10x8. Limpieza, obviamente yo tengo sensibilidad, no estoy usando ni máscara acá adentro, no hay polvo, no hay...
No.
Esto está limpio aquí, esto está...
Vamos a limpiar todos los días, como te dije, hoy fue un día de carrera, no fue mejor la limpieza como sea, como
sí.
Dos días, pero...
Wow.
Siempre se trata de limpiar lo mejor que se puede.
Sí, y el techo está súper alto.
El techo está alto.
El carro sale para arriba.
Sí.
Mira esto.
Estas son las palomas que llegaron hoy de carrera.
Ok.
Uno está un poquito más estropeado, uno está mejor.
Sí. Bueno, fueron 500 millas, imagínate.
Fueron 500 millas, pero de 25 mandé 19. Digo, llegaron 19, perdón.
Sí, claro. Tienen que estar cansados, imagínate, 500 millas.
Sí.
Hoy una paloma entró medio hora, más o menos media hora antes.
Media hora antes,
un vecino tuyo aquí.
Sí.
Okay.
Okay. Los demás estamos ahí peleando de segundo lugar para abajo.
Sí. Wow, y tienes una visión casi para dropper.
No exactamente. No necesariamente, lo que pasa es que...
Entonces, como podemos notar, lo que es la limpieza y el espacio es esencial para la cría.
Sí.
O sea...
Aquí se crían 200 pichones o se entran 200 pichones,
sí.
Pero tienen el palomar completo para ellos.
Claro.
Cada pichón, las divisiones son para 42 palomas,
sí.
Pero no va más de 20.
Claro.
Para que puedan estar cómodos. Abren por debajo las puertas para que se vayan, una vez están todos los pichones,
sí.
Pues se abren para que ellos pasen y estén libres.
Claro.
Los machos siempre... Yo soy el tipo que más segundos tiene en el JC.
Yeah.
Porque las palomas no se pueden tirar de frente.
Sí. La paloma de Luis Rodríguez, cuando rompen, que también es boricua.
Rompen aquí.
Rompen por aquí.
Sí.
Pasan por allá. Sí, yo estaba en la casa de él, yo le hice un video de él, la casa, como like, media hora. Me hicieron todas las palomas, todos los palomares. Sí.
Driveway, it's like going through a jungle to get in and out of this house. There's like a gate they have to open. It's like a whole military drill to get in here.
That's a little loft right there. I don't know. But the big one is, that's a loft. It looks like a house. That's a loft.
That's a loft.
That's insane.
Get that next to it. That's a loft.
Yeah, there's a little house there. An abandoned pigeon coop. It looks like a house in New Orleans. Gross. This is supposed to be a new guy in town. He already built that loft. It's beautiful. Right here, whatever loft that is. He used to live up in Fort Myers in our combine. My face. Anyways, we're going to the clubhouse now. See who won today's race. Apparently, the loft right behind the loft where we were, Dutchman, had a pigeon 30 minutes before he did, so that might be a win. We'll find out. Hopefully, we're not too late. So, we'll see where we're going. People are leaving, that's not good. We gotta hurry up and get there to the GAC club. My video. This is the little baby that I'm putting in the classic. There's a blue bar. Nice little blue bar. Look at that. OK. Okay, a nice little blue bar. I think it's a cockbird. And the band number is 643 Ochoa, 2016. It's one of my little babies that I'm putting in the classic. And there's another little baby that I'm putting in the classic race. They're nestmates. This one's still a little bit young, but it's a dark check. These are out of Ross's. It's got frill on the neck. It's got frill on the neck, and it's got feathers on its feet, which is kind of odd because it's not really an inbred. It's out of Cuban birds crossed with American birds. There's no reason for it to be an inbred, but those are my birds.
Two winners for the classic.
Yes. All right. The classic. This is my handler dragging off for the classic.
And we're
going to
win it.
I hope we do, man.
That's right.
I know he's the handler of the bird.
So I'll see
you. Go my bird, man. Take care of it.
Thank you.
He was drinking happy. He took my bird, so I got really good handler for the classic. This is totally unexpected. I just said, let's go to GHC. I took some birds, and now they're in the classic, and we'll see how they do. Win or lose, we have fun. And definitely the people that are handling my birds this year, Dragon and Saul, are cool guys. It makes me happy for them to have my birds. So that's what's up. We're gonna go back to the hotel and that's it. So this is today's race. And see that dragon right there?
Rodriguez, Mr. Number One.
We're gonna change your name to Rodriguez.
As a little brother of
your little brother,
Grande Rodriguez.
So this is the next Rodriguez in town.
That's right.
Congratulations, man.
And Mr. Blank.
Now they're gonna drug test you.
That's alright. They've been down drug testing all my life.
I gotta go. So what are we looking at here?
This is an inbred Seco. She has Seco, I think it's six times in her pedigree.
Wow. Beautiful.
Beautiful handling bird. Nice step, nice wing. Primaries are almost all equal. And this one is a son of 410. Top-notch eye.
Yeah.
For those eye sign people.
There you go. Wow, what an eye, impressive.
Yes, this is a son of 410, and we will see. And it's more a preventive medicine.
Yeah.
If you give the bird good feed, good ventilation, I don't mean a draft, I mean nice ventilation. Give it all the supplements it needs, you probably won't encounter too many problems in your loft.
Okay.
And the other thing is, never overcrowd.
Okay. Overcrowding it, wherever there's overcrowding.
There's always disease.
Exactly.
Keep your loft dry. That's, humidity is a disaster.
Yeah.
So that's what we try. I mean, I have fans, extractors up in the rafters.
Yep.
Push air outside when it gets too hot.
You've got sunlight.
Yes, that's right. I've got light, natural light coming in.
Yep.
And today is a very cloudy, dark day.
And we're still able to. Exactly. Absolutely.
Still have enough light in the loft.
Plenty of light.
See what we have here, some of the breeders. Bred this year for one of the races. To fly special races here in the Spring Hills. We pretty much have a little bit of everything. Hoovens, Jansens,
Leo Herrmanns.
Herrmanns, yes.
Rick Cools, Chris Plateau.
Mm-hmm. What's the other guy, the ones with
Ari Dykstra.
Yep.
I guess Van Loon.
Yeah,
I mean a little bit of everything.
So that way, you know, when people see it, this is how we breed. Okay, individual cages. When people ask for a pair of birds, they always said, "I want out of this pair." So we made sure it's out of this pair. You don't need to DNA. We save all that time. We breed what we have, and they get what they look for, what they want. Like I said, it brought us $30,000 already. year after year. We have a lot of Hoobins in here. We got a real good success with those, especially one pair over there.
Mm-hmm.
We bred one pair out of them and turned out to be one of our best birds. I mean, we were leading on champion bird, but you know, we've been busy. We were building all day, so.
I have, this loft is cleaned daily. I have a hired hand that comes in, does a complete cleaning of both lofts, the flying and the breeding, every day. And I take care of the water feed medication. By medication, I mean supplements that are required in order to maintain your birds in good health.
Exactly.
We try to shy away from treatments, because if you just take good care of your birds, you rarely get stuck with a problem of having to use harsh medications. That bloodline just won last year $100,000.
Wow.
And in past years, if I show you the pedigree, he has Triple Crown Classic winner and money
for
like two or three of his ancestors.
Beautiful.
So, red bloodline we have, which also carries the Bernese, the Leon.
Like I said, they're family again. It's a little hard to explain. That's her aunt, her half sister, and cousin, these two. And that's one of the reasons we wanted to keep them, because this is how close we can get to the blood. Can't get closer because they'll come out a little retarded. You can see when you get too close in breeding, feather feet.
Yeah.
Okay, so this one's got some feathers.
Seems like everywhere in Spring Hill now, you see a lot of Cuban and Mexican restaurants, little by little. It's starting to be from a normally American community, starting to turn more Hispanic. So what are we looking at here?
Hoobins, pair of Hoobins, the ones that I imported.
Pure Hooban?
Yep.
Yeah, he sure is. So that's a pure Hooban imported?
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah, I know, I like that.
What's he mostly out of?
He's got a lot of the young artists in the background. You know, it's grandson, you know. So, they're supposed to be some of the best ones that they have left. You know, like I said, there's no more Hoobins anymore, so this is what they have. So I bought four of them. So this pair, there's another pair back there. And right next to them, you can see, that's a Hoobin family that I create. The hen, he came out of Perfecto, which is a lot of people who know Hoobins, they know Perfecto. This is out of my red cock, the one you saw in the other loft.
Mm-hmm.
As the father, and the mother is a daughter out of my 79, which my 79 was one of my best birds I ever have. That hen, with that hen, they're related. That's cousins, those two hens.
Yeah, my brother's in front of him.
He's not gonna fly, he's gonna keep it for
breeder. Oh, he's gonna start it, yeah, great, man.
Yeah. I mean, except to him, he wants to fly it. I won't recommend him to fly it.
Yeah, he'll probably start it, yeah.
Yeah, that's for stock. Let me tell you, they came out. I was very impressed with those birds.
My brother's big on them.
On the Mona Lisa birds.
Yeah.
Here,
yeah.
There's a purpose there for keep the babies for breeding, you know, for stock, you know.
Supposedly, the best cross for the Mona Lisas and all that, and the Hopkins.
The Hopkins, yeah.
Or the Hoobins.
Yep, and the Hoobins. Yep.
So that's probably why.
Hoobins, actually,
that's probably why he wants it.
Yeah.
Because that's the rumor is, that's a good cross. But it's really hard to get at your hand. You can buy the Hopkins, but
yeah,
the Hoobins.
Well, actually,
really,
there's a guy in California, Rafael Reyes. He's got good Hopkins. You know, I mean, a friend requested on Facebook, so he accepted it. Yeah. So I'm going to call him and see if we get some of the Hopkins. I want to cross it with his family because I don't have any of them.
I've been so slow on Facebook. I deleted most everybody off Facebook.
Yeah.
I'm just tired of it.
I got to breed another pair for my other good friend, Marvin Cortez, which is brother Mike Cortez.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I promised him that I was going to bring him a pair. So he wants a pair of these babies. So he's going to give me some of his good blood. I'm going to give him some of my good blood. So that's how we do it, you know. Started with that Five Amigos.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, I'm friendly with everybody. So we started with the races, you know. I mean, not bragging that my birds, they win the money, but I like to share it with everybody.
Yeah.
You know, everybody has a opportunity of the money, so
yeah.
I don't care. If anybody wants to enjoy the Five Amigos, you know, we're missing a partner for the South Carolina,
yeah.
More than welcome to call me, you know.
Yeah.
It goes one bird each person, and we share everything equally,
yeah.
Everything, even shipping, you know.
Yeah. Out of the main cock, the red one.
Okay, that's all three cages.
Yeah, that's his daughter. That's his son's one.
Mm-hmm.
It's a full brother out of those silvers that flew super good. It's like I said, the first brother won $13,000. The second brother won $9,000 from the Five Amigos. Okay. One of these birds, his nest mate, went to California, donated to Freddie Rivera. I don't know which auction it went. I wish I could have the bird back. It was a hen. Okay. This bird already bred a classic on 2012, if I'm not mistaken. She bred a good one.
Yeah.
Breed. You know, that's what I kind of, when I went to Will,
mm-hmm.
I told Will, say, if we're going to spend all this money, I want you to put individuals. I don't like to breed in an open loft because you don't know who jumps on top of who. You can tell who's the mother, but you will never can tell who's the father. Okay, out of these, I can always guarantee.
Oh, look at the little youngster.
He came out of this pair. He came out. They're brothers on the mother's side, not on the father's side. And what I'm trying to create is get some of this blood, you know, mingling with that blood, so that way I can get the whole family back again. You know, I mean, I'm a big believer in breeding and line breeding. You know, I learned that from David Clausen, which is a good friend of mine.
Yeah.
And he's the one that teach me a lot of this stuff, you know? He always said, watch my pedigrees, you know, watch Rubens pedigrees, read them, and I did.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of my good Rubens, it came out of my inbreds, you know.
So, I called David Clausen. He'd talk to you on the phone for hours if you let him.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, he likes to talk.
Yeah, but he's got good stories, man.
He knows a lot about inbreds.
I'll tell you what, I mean, not bragging or anything, but he's one of the most, I would say, persons that has been done a lot in South Africa.
Mm-hmm.
Even though that right now he's a little, you know, down, but he'll get up again, you know. I mean, nobody has done, not even close to what he's done already, you
just,
know,
just,
winning too
just
many.
Just look at, yeah. When you go to loft to loft here in Florida,
yeah.
Clausen holding is the number one favorite,
yeah.
of many, many
you know,
people.
A lot of the blood over there in South Africa, they're winning out of the, you know,
yeah.
Clausen's blood, you know.
Yeah. Yeah.
And you can
whether,
see.
Whether acknowledged or not.
Mm-hmm. You know,
is that import?
Yeah, it's another import. That hand right there, that's out of, it comes out of Clausen's family. I bred it. It comes out of 79 with my 152 from Larry Hedge. Super birds. She's I think she was fourth place on Flamingo, 400 miles. You know, I just too much luck with them. Her daughter got a first place and second place on with AAA on 2013. Again, we just did it again with the Hoovens, you know. I mean, it's nothing but money with those birds, you know. I bred it differently this year, you know. His main cock is over there. Well, I'm going to show you in a minute. But too much good luck with them. Great young artist, okay. The mother is out of my imports, which is he's a half-brother of those two right there that you just saw previous, okay. Made it with the... what's it called? An inbred sickle. Okay. His mother and his father, they were super, super birds. A lot of these bloodline wins in Miami for the twin brothers. Manny.
Rodriguez?
Yeah, the Rodriguez brothers.
They have, in my opinion, some of the best results.
Oh, yes. Those guys
Florida.
Are good. Yep. Those guys are good.
So,
Reynaldo and
yeah.
I forgot the other ones. Yeah.
Yeah, they're good.
Yeah.
They've just about all the
yeah
the races that are tough.
Yeah. So him with that hand over there, I just got so much money. You know, we sent some birds to Puerto Rico. Something happened in Puerto Rico. The birds that disappear. We recovered just one. It's in Pennsylvania right now with my other friend. I tried to make this bird with this import hand right here. You know, we got two babies. I wanna keep those babies. See what happens this year. So, you know, like I said, I'm a Hooven person. So,
mm-hmm.
Love of Kenny Chen, Chinese guy.
Yeah.
Yeah. And these this guy.
Oh, look at him. Right?
Yeah, I flew him on 2014, I believe. He flew extremely good. The only problem with this bird, he didn't like to come down. He always loved to fly. Kind of got mad at him a little bit because he made me lost a couple of times because he overflew. You know, he just didn't have the desire to go back inside his loft. You know, he was so happy. I bred a baby out of him with the Kennedy Chin's hen, another hen that I have in the loft. I got 8 place on the 100 miles. I got 34 place on the 200 miles. And we scored on the 300. I forgot what the place was. So I made it with this other hand, so I want to see what happens.
The babies look beautiful.
Yeah, we got to send them to Triple Crown.
Nice.
One of these schools.
What's up with the hand? She's not even letting me, like,
oh, no, she's wild.
She's wild.
Yeah.
She's
not. See, I don't touch these birds. You know, yeah. All I do is just feed them and leave, and that's it. You know, I try not to touch them, not to mess around with them. I mean, I don't like to touch birds.
She came up to the camera almost, turned on you. She was like,
Yeah. Nice. But, this is how I keep them. This is how I breed. You know, like I told you before.
A lot of space.
I'm a big believer in if you have a good pair of birds, this is how you breed, and then you definitely will know if they're a good pair of birds or not.
Yeah.
Okay. Sure. Like I said, my red one, all he bred is in individual cages, and all the babies that we got year after year, they were super. So.
These are the money winners.
Yeah.
These are the one loft raisers.
Yeah. Believe it or not, we put them together, those two males, and that little one, you know, he was a little meaner to the other one, so we had to kind of separate him. A little bit of the cannibal, he has a little bit of the Johnson, a little bit of Hooven, a little bit of everything. Mm-hmm. I bought these birds in 2008 from a guy, Breck Arian, which is a lot of people might know now him. You know, he's pretty good.
You can see the cannibal in the eye.
Yeah. Like I said, about those 16 birds, I only got 4 left. Again, I bought this Kalia hen from a friend of mine up in Chicago, okay? Made them together, I wanna see what happens. This is the first year being together. I wanna introduce this Kalia family to my Kalia family, okay? Right here you can see it. That little blue checker white fly, that's his daughter. She also made money on flamingo, okay? She flew good. So that's why I kept the family here. And she's made up with his brother, half brother.
A lot of
his
colors.
His name is Chico.
Chico. Oh, Chico.
Mm-hmm.
Like chicken.
And that's the other one right there. Hens are laying eggs like crazy, so mm-hmm. We're gonna, as soon as we get enough eggs, we're gonna, you know, put them together, so hopefully we get some babies.
What type of chicken are these?
How do they call them? Bannon chickens? Something like that.
Yeah.
We call them kikirikis.
Kikiri.
Yeah, kikirikis.
Yeah, kikiri.
Kind of cute,
yeah.
Kind of tall. Black Russian Terrier.
Oh wow!
It's a baby, right?
Yeah, it's a baby.
That's a beautiful dog.
Yeah,
I've never seen it.
A year old.
Wow! So this is a puppy.
Mm-hmm.
That is beautiful. And I don't
see,
even.
He's jealous because you're not petting him.
Yeah.
Come on, Mike. Let's go pee pee. Come on.
Go. He'll knock you down.
Come on.
He'll knock me down. Back over there. My friend Luis Rodriguez's lofts. Once you're in this area of Spring Hill, just about everywhere you look, there's pigeon lofts. It's just so weird. And the camera's acting up because, a lot of humidity. It's been raining a lot, so the camera's really struggling to deal with the moisture. It's not really meant to be wet. As you can see, there's a pigeon loft behind that house. Right behind, oh, there's a huge loft right there. There's a truck pulling in, there's a huge loft right there. Just everywhere, there's just pigeon people place.
Cairo, Georgia.
Alright, this is south corner of Georgia.
Yeah, 15 miles of Georgia, Florida line.
Nice. What's your name?
Sylvester Tillman.
All right, Mr. Tillman. What drew you to the pigeon sport?
A cousin of mine in Virginia.
Okay.
Came down for a family reunion, kept talking about it.
So you got family up north for pigeons?
Yeah. He's been doing it since he was 8.
Wow.
So I got into it actually the first of this year.
Okay.
I built my loft, and as you can see, it's still a little work in progress.
Nah, but it's nice. I mean, I like the wood.
Yeah, it's a work in progress, like I said. But,
Wesley gave me that white and black bird. Oh, right, you said what you want to call it.
Hernandez?
Yeah, Hernandez gave me the six breeders. And then Toni gave me the two white and black breeders and this silver cock right here.
Got it. And you said the little grizzle up front, up talking from Obi?
Yeah, that's the grizzle right there from Obi. And that silver hen.
Alright, so they're not selling you the birds around here?
No, they first round they're giving me the birds this year, but
there's some cool guys around here.
Yeah.
Alright, well, I can say, you know, for being your first time with birds, the loft is clean, you built it well, and the birds look spectacular, man. These young birds, look at these.
All of this will be coming down. I'm gonna make partition walls, a wall with them, you know, that I can take down. But I'm gonna make it like out of a PVC pipe.
Yep, I've seen it. Yeah.
Yeah. That way, I'm worried about the wire hurting.
Yeah, well, the feathers.
Yeah, because they're always climbing up and
then messes up their feathers.
Hung in there. So.
These are already flying outside.
Yeah.
Nice.
I everybody but those two.
All right.
The grizzle and the white and black one, those are the only two that haven't flown yet. I just got them last week, so.
First one you've brought here?
Yeah.
The old saying is, lift up the wing underneath it, and does it feel wet or dry? Like up underneath here? If they're little, really little, it's gonna be wet down here. When they're big like that, they're dry. So about that one looks about ready to come up. I mean, if the parents are still feeding it,
yeah,
let it sit there a little bit, you know.
Yeah. Mom and dad going over there.
When I get the rest of the birds in here, they were supposed to be getting five or six more in a couple more weeks from Wesley.
They're aggressive on that side over there, though.
But this one, I call that king cock right there.
Yeah.
That
you gotta come on, man.
That white and black one up there, I call that one John Jones.
Yeah.
And then that red one, he's the second king of cocks.
Yeah.
if it ain't that one pushing everybody, him. He won't let nobody fly up here.
Dude, the birds that this guy gives you, man, that's not garbage, man. That's just from looking at it. See the big waddle?
Uh-huh.
You don't see that too much anymore.
Yeah.
Big waddle.
It turned upside down.
Yeah, you gotta be careful. Birds, they're curious. Anything that you put in the loft, they're gonna find out.
I use that one for, you know, the perennial green pellets.
Yeah.
I use that for that one, but I changed over to this milk jug. Use smaller holes.
Yeah, pigeons, I mean, they're curious. Anything you put in here, they're gonna figure out what it is and what it does. I figured that out too.
I just cut these holes about 2 weeks ago. No, about 3 weeks ago. In the back here.
So you got ventilation on the bottom?
Yeah, I got ventilation here. I'm going to put ventilation here.
Got it.
I'm going to put ventilation one there and one here so I get anything that comes up this way, go out that way.
Wow, nice. I don't know, man. These birds look beautiful.
That grizzle, man, he is big, ain't he?
Yeah.
He's bigger than any one of my young birds. And they way older than him. One of them in there at least got him at Janus before.
Now you lying, man. You've had pigeons your whole life. somebody coming here and doing it for you.
It's all me.
Nah, man.
Yep. I watch the videos.
You watch the videos, huh?
I watch the videos.
Man.
I watch the videos and I listen to what Toni tell me.
Wow, man. Are you kidding me? For being your first year? Nah, man. You got good loft condition. The birds are great. The loft is clean. I'd be scared to fly against you.
Well, we'll see.
Yeah.
A guy gave me...
What you'll be flying with?
Oh. I think it's South Georgia... Something.
South Georgia something.
Sure. I ain't up on all that yet.
But you do know the guys already.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, what I find interesting about you is even though you're new in the sport, you already know everybody.
Yeah. I'm getting around, you know.
Yeah, and that's why your birds look good.
Yeah, I try to feed them pretty good. You know,
It's all them. It's not me.
Yeah, it's all. I don't know, man. I mean, it's your first year flying. You know everybody, and your birds look spectacular.
Yeah, they do pretty good. I like them. I love them, man.
Yeah.
I sit on my deck, man, and just, I can sit out there and watch them for hours. I sit in there with them.
Yeah.
You know, sometimes they'll come to me. You know, come up to me, and I had one flying, laying right on my stomach. Now that was a. I like that.
Yeah.
I want them to land on my shoulder and stay there for a while.
They will, if you feed them. If they know that your hand gives them food, they will.
Yeah.
They sure will. Sometimes
you've got a lot to learn, but.
Yeah. I think already, just by, you know, appreciating how clean your loft is, how good your birds look, and how many people you can call when you're in trouble, you're going to be all right, man.
Yeah, I'll be ringing your phone, too.
That's all right.
You might want to do it wrong.
Yeah, you might want to ask somebody who knows what they're doing, though, not me.
You know what you're doing.
I've had many great pigeons in my life. I've had pigeons for over 80 years, and I had a pigeon that was a hen, 1265 was her number. She may have been the best pigeon I ever owned. I've had a few Hall of Fame winners that won the AU Hall of Fame for me, and I've had a lot of great pigeons. I had a pigeon 299 that was the high champion point bird in the United States for a few years. Both his father and mother I imported from the Jensen brothers in the late 60s. The father of them was a half brother to the Merks. The father is of the Merks, rather, and my 299 came from the Dunker Steer, which was the father of the Merks. So I had many good pigeons. I had many good friends in Belgium and brought many good pigeons in for
are all
60, 70 years.
Yes. Are all exceptional flyers, exceptional breeders?
All
exceptional flying pigeons also are they guaranteed to be exceptional breeders as well?
No, not at all. There's many pigeons that have flown well and don't breed well, but that's happened with horses too.
If yes.
You take Whirlaway, who won the Triple Crown in 1941, he was a failure at stud. If you take Citation, which I think was the best horse that I ever saw, Citation won the Triple Crown. He was the best horse I ever saw, and he was a failure at stud. Both those horses won the Triple Crown, and both of them were failures in America. They were sold to Marcel Boussac in France because they didn't cut the mustard for Calumet Farms. And, but many, many good horses, good pigeons, good dogs. It's an exceptional one that is a good breeder and a good flyer. Some of the best breeders that ever bred were good horses, but not the most exceptional race horses. Bull Ruler being one was a good horse, and son of Nash Ruler, he was one of the top breeders of all time, and he was a good horse, but not a great horse.
Do you think, like the big Andy Warloff that we have here in Spring Hill, the GHC Classic, do you think these events in the future are going to keep growing? How do you see the future here?
Well, we hope that it keeps growing. We hope that it keeps... Spring Hill is a lovely place to be living. The weather's wonderful, and the competition is, I think, is as high as it can get in the United States. We hope that the sport
continues
and survives. And,
what advice can you give to the next generation of us younger people to accomplish that?
Well, enjoy yourself. And if you're not successful, don't be discouraged and quit.
Exactly. Or be miserable. I know fanciers that are not exactly the best racers, and they still enjoy the sport.
Yeah, well, that's what you got to do. You better enjoy the sport. That's what it is. The sport and it's for having fun. Enjoy the camaraderie and enjoy...
Do it with sportsmanship.
Yes, absolutely.
Thank you so much for your time. It's been a pleasure to speak with you.
My pleasure.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate it.
You're welcome, and it's always my pleasure. You keep up the good work.
I will. Thank you so much for everything you've done for the sport. They consider you a living legend. And that hasn't been granted. It's been through hard work, dedication. And you have the appreciation of everybody. That's why I'm very happy to have you here on my channel.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for your time. I appreciate it. Rodriguez. I am a pigeon racing video maker. Didn't go to school to be a pigeon photographer or a photography video making school. My school has just been learning and taking advice from people, and people tell you do this to make your videos better, do that to make your videos better. I started making my pigeon racing videos because I was just trying to document my liberations as a driver, and I didn't want anybody to think that I wasn't being honest, so I always recorded the liberation. And that kind of snowballed into making these videos, and here we are, 500 miles from home, 800 miles from home, interviewing people, meeting people, and going to all these lofts that are famous. It's a great gift that the pigeon racing community has given me. I like pigeon racers that, like the ones we've met today, like the police officer in Louisiana, like Marengo Creek Loft, Farm Loft, people like that, people that I feel love the pigeons themselves. I've always been an animal lover. Growing up as a kid, the crocodile hunter Steve Irwin was like my childhood hero, and I wanted to be like him, and I never thought I'd be able to have an audience and a following just like he did, doing what you believe is right, thinking that what you're doing is for a good cause, and entertaining people while you're doing it, being yourself while you're doing it, has always meant a lot to me. I like real people. I like to go somewhere and have barbecue and wait for the birds. And even if we win or lose, it doesn't matter. It's just about enjoying the event. And that's the type of pigeon racer I like to hang out with, to meet. Of course, you have to deal with everybody, and the pigeon racing sport depends on all types of people. But these are the type of people that I enjoy to deal with. People like Scotty, people like Gabriel, people like Old Man Ross, and like the people that we're interviewing up here in Georgia. There's just genuine people, Louisiana, all these people are just genuine. You feel the love, you feel welcome, and that's what I like to do videos for. I like to do videos for people who are real, genuine, and are animal lovers, and that's the way I believe the sport should be. Thank you.